This morning's scripture lesson is Matthew 21, verses 1 to 11. Please listen to the word of God. When Jesus and his disciples had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Lord, we've been on this Lent journey, and we've been looking for you, Lord. We find you in all the paths of our lives. Sometimes in the paths that we don't want to take. And so, Lord, we ask for your strength and guidance as we continue to walk in your footsteps. I ask for your guidance as I present your word to your people, Lord. May you bless us all with wisdom and truth and light that will see us through any darkness. In your holy name, I pray. Don't worry, I know this stuff this year. Why did I really put the dog on top this year? Okay. You know what? Yeah, I'll just leave. So, prayer. When you're a minister, you have a lot, becoming a minister, a lot of hard duties and difficult challenges that you didn't really expect. One of the hardest things about my job sometimes is actually trying to explain what it is that I do, especially to people that don't go to church, and especially to friends and family members who knew me before I was a minister, or don't really know about church. If any of you have ever tried to talk to your grandchildren, let's say, about what you do at church or why you go to church, you might appreciate, you know, your grandchildren don't normally go, you might appreciate how difficult this conversation can be. I mean, it's kind of hard to tell your grandchildren that their parents are heathens, and even though they were raised correctly, and you're sure that it would be good for them, they've somehow turned their back on everything you've taught them. And it's tough. Now, you try doing that when you're a minister who actually goes to that church. So my nephew will ask me, what do you do? And I say, "Well, I comfort sick people." "Oh, so you're a doctor?" "No, I'm not a doctor. I teach people about how to live." "Oh, so you're a teacher?" "Well, no, I'm not really a teacher. I teach people how to have a relationship with Jesus." "You mean that guy on the plus side?" "Well, just talk to your dad, ask him." It's difficult, it's hard to get through. And I did get through, I think, to my nephew when he was 5 years old. And in a very surprising way to me, it was through prayer. Whenever we have a family gathering at my parents' house, it's always an event. Even if we do it 2 weeks in a row, once a month. It's still a big event. There's always lots of food and fun. And as my nephew once said, he said, at our house we just have meals, but when we're at grandma's house, we have a feast. And because it's kind of a special occasion, and because I'm a minister, we always pray before we have our meal. And it was just sort of, it was the normal thing that we did. And I didn't really think it made any impact until I learned from my brother that his kids started to ask, hey, why don't we pray before our meals? And they started wanting to pray. And so the dad said, okay, let's pray. And he thought maybe this was a fad or a whim. But prayer has power. It can't just be left alone independently. It makes room for God, makes things move. So with prayer came more of a routine. And my brother started to say, it makes us feel like we're having more of a family meal, family get together. I really like this prayer. And then a few weeks later, the kids started to ask questions about God and Jesus. And it became more and more part of their life until, maybe we should start looking for a church. And now they are looking for a church. They're starting to go and try to find a place that's good for their family and good for their kids. Unfortunately, they're a little too far away from this church. But it just shows how prayer can move people into changing their lives and changing into action. And through Lent, I've been talking about prayer. About how prayer is more than just words or something said in a moment, but an entire journey with its ups and downs, and how we need to learn how to pray without ceasing by trying different techniques of prayer, different ways to pray. We've learned about praying through silence, praying through reading the scriptures, praying through examining our lives and confession, praying using our imagination. And now, I think as Lent is coming to a close, I want to focus on sort of the end result of prayer. Because prayer is much more than we ought to give credit for. People will ask, well, why do you pray? God already knows what you want. Or even more importantly, God knows what we need. Or if you're a really good Calvinist, the argument is, well, everything's predestined anyway, so what's the point of prayer? But hopefully we've learned that prayer, those questions are all flawed thinking, because they're all about assuming that you can control God through your prayers. Or get something out of it, or it's an earthly, they're focused on earthly conceptions of prayer. Rather than the real spirit of prayer is to open yourself up and let God work through you. It's to work with God. Prayer is about purifying ourselves through confessing our sins and expressing our fears and our desires. It's about finding illumination and inspiration through listening to the Word of God. It's about ultimately communion with God, developing that relationship and growing and walking with God. And finally, the result of that is action. Because as prayer changes our inner spiritual life, it changes our behavior, which then changes how we respond to the world and how the world responds to us. And that is the important, that is the important thing about prayer. And I think we've also maybe talked a little bit about there's two kinds of prayer. There's the listening, there's prayer that is talking to God, which is expressing all of our thoughts and feelings, examining our day, our confessions, our thanks, our praise, even our requests. And that leads towards action because it's using our own internal processes to talk to God, to tell God about ourselves, and through that, we learn about ourselves. And we figure out what we've done wrong and how we can change. And we can further gain insights into our walk with God. Or we listen to God by reading scripture, by meditating, by silence. And we get new insights that we would have never thought of on our own. Divine inspiration. We look at things in a different way. But all of these things end up changing who we are and then changing our behavior and changing the world around us. We look at the world with different eyes. And so we act differently. And then the world is going to act differently to us. And that's what brings me to this scripture, which is Palm Sunday. And it is the beginning, Holy Week, is the culmination, the whole purpose of the Gospels is about this week and the crucifixion and then the resurrection. In fact, this actually is just realized you have the cross and then you have the picture of the resurrection right above it. That's the center of the Gospels. And why is that so important? Well, Jesus went around teaching. He went around healing. It was all preparation. Just as we talked about on Transfiguration Sunday, he went up the mountain, he prayed, but then he came back down the mountain and went into action. This is an even bigger example of that. All preparation, the whole Gospel is a story of preparation for this big act, which is Holy Week, the crucifixion, the sacrifice, and the overcoming, the resurrection. And that's where the prayer turns into action. I don't think this Palm Sunday, we see Jesus coming in, and everybody's waiting with palms. But it's a really radical thing, actually. In the minds of the people who Jesus was preaching to. At this exact same time as you had a bunch of peasants waving palm branches at a carpenter on a donkey. On the other end of the city, during Passover, you had the Roman authorities, the governor coming in with his soldiers around him, waving their swords as he rode on a big stallion. And he was coming to make sure everybody was alive, to put people in their place. It was a display of power and force and war. And everybody thought that the Messiah was going to counter that power with an even greater power. And he did, but it wasn't what they expected. It was a new power. He countered war with peace. He countered hate and vengeance with love. He countered power with humility. His prayers led him to weep, not to scream. And in the end, his prayers led him to the cross, to be the sacrifice. But it did end there because through his death, he gained victory. The sacrifice became the salvation. Prayer turned into action, which then saved us all, which showed us the way. And this is the journey that we're going on, this Lent, this Holy Week, and even into the future. We focused Throughout Lent, we focused a lot on prayer. And my thought is after Easter, I'm going to start talking more about action, what we need to do. What is our mission? How do we walk forward? How do we act out this love and this prayer? And so think about what you've learned this Lent. And if you didn't do much this Lent, it's not too late. You still got the Holy Week. Do the through the whole Holy Week. Meditate on where is God taking you in your life? What does your prayer inspire you to do and to be? Prayer is, to end, I mean, with the story that there was a, I read this book about, it was written by an atheist, and he was complaining about these nuns who every day they prayed for world peace, and he couldn't figure out what that was all about. Why he never asked them, I don't know. But he said, oh, yeah, how could they do that? And I thought, well, they're a witness. That they are praying for world peace, and they are changing themselves into peaceful people. They are inspiring other peaceful people, and they are bringing peace to the world slowly but surely. Prayer is not in vain if it doesn't change the world. Prayer is only in vain if it doesn't change you. If it changes you, then it will change the world.